त्याचबरोबरीनं आपण शेवटी एंट्री 52 ही गेल्यामुळे आता 11 तर जाणार, पण त्याच्यासाठी जो आपल्याला संविधानाचे अनुच्छेद 243(x) असं काहीतरी आपल्याकडे तरतूद आहे आणि त्याच्यातून आपल्याला जर राज्य शासनासाठी GST कायद्यात स्थानिक संस्थांना द्यावयाच्या वाट्यापोटी सुस्पष्ट व्यवस्था करता येईल आणि तशी व्यवस्था आपण केली तर ह्या येणाऱ्या GST बद्दल ज्या शंका व्यक्त करतात, जे प्रश्न आहेत, काही मनामध्ये भीती आहे, ती दूर होऊ शकेल. मला वाटतं की आपलं राज्य सरकार हे या दृष्टीने संवेदनशील आहे आणि योग्य तो न्याय मुंबईसारख्या महानगरीला, मुंबई जशी महाराष्ट्राची राजधानी तशी देशाची ती आर्थिक राजधानी, हे एक यंत्र आहे प्रचंड मोठं आणि इथून धन निर्माण होतं, तेव्हा धन निर्माण करणारं हे महायंत्र सतत चालू राहावं, सुरळीत चालू राहावं ही पाहायची जबाबदारी आपली सर्वांची आहे. तेव्हा मुंबईला तुम्ही चिंतामुक्त कराल असा मी विश्वास व्यक्त करतो. शेवटी एकच आहे की आर्य चाणक्यानं काय म्हटलं होतं की कर वसुली ही करदात्याला वेदना देणारी नसावी. मधमाशी जसे फुलातला हवा तेवढाच मध घेते आणि ते मध शोषून घेताना फुलाचं कुठलं नुकसान करत नाही, नासधूस करत नाही. फुले सुरक्षित असते, मधमाशी सुद्धा जगते आणि दोघांचंही काम व्यवस्थित चालतं. आपली कर वसुली ही अशी असावी ही चाणक्याने त्या काळात व्यक्त केलेली अपेक्षा. मला वाटतं की आताच्या काळात GST प्रणाली लागू झाल्यानंतर सुद्धा ही पाळली जाईल आणि नागरिकांना सध्याच्या प्रचलित कर पद्धतीमुळे होणारा असलेला त्रास हा कमी होईल, किंबहुना अधिक सुलभ आणि चांगल्या कर व्यवस्थेमध्ये जगण्याचं, कामकाज करण्याचं एक समाधान पुढच्या काळामध्ये भारतीय नागरिकांना, महाराष्ट्राच्या नागरिकांना, मुंबईकरांना मिळेल अशी अपेक्षा व्यक्त करतो आणि 4 शब्द पूर्ण करतो. जय हिंद, जय महाराष्ट्र.
Chief Minister, who actually spent almost a decade in the Prime Minister's office, who worked tirelessly for GST. So there's not much for me to speak, but I will take a few minutes. And sir, thank you for staying back. I will start in the reverse order because many points have been covered. So number one, please let's recognize that Maharashtra state, 110 million people, the most industrialized state, which gets at one time 50% of the country's FDI, is a very important, very distinctive state. And now you're going to be part of the GST Council, you're going for the meeting on Thursday. So these issues have to be, I think, tabled there. There is a lot of risk of getting sort of outvoted and so on. So please, you know, these are very important issues. Secondly, Mumbai is even more important. It's the financial capital of the country. Under the former finance minister, we announced it as the International Financial Center. It is seen as a nationally important place, not just the capital of Maharashtra. So the what the industry minister said, let me reiterate that, that, you know, in one hand, it is fashionable to say outcry from the days of Aurangzeb and only North Korea or some other country has it. But sir, this is the key source of swayatta, autonomy to the city. This city has unfortunately 65% of the population living in the slums who don't pay property tax. So 65% of the other way to get some kind of an equity about taxation in the population of this city is unfortunately through octroi. And that's going to go away. And we have no visibility on how that is going to be replaced. And just by pointing fingers to other states like Gujarat, who have this mechanism where out of the state VAT, there's an automatic devolution or some formula to cities, that will not work in Maharashtra. because Maharashtra is one of the most urbanized state in the country. Next, I think Tamil Nadu, Bengal, and Maharashtra. But unlike Bengal, which has only one major metropolitan center, and Tamil Nadu perhaps one or two, Maharashtra has 23 municipal corporations, mega corporations. And therefore, their swayatta, their autonomy is very important. So we have to think about, I think as our former chief minister said, the other mechanism is to have a state finance commission, but which has some teeth. I mean, संविधानिक जर महत्व म्हणजे काही स्टेटस दिलं, because we have had 3 or 4 state finance commissions, but their recommendations go largely unimplemented. So even if they recommend that this much money should come to Mumbai city or Nagpur or Pune, and if it's not implemented, then we have not solved the problem. So please, sir, have a look at this. आणि असं होता का नाही, कारण different municipal corporations have the municipality is ruled by different political parties. So it should not be the case that if it is left to the mercy of the state government to allocate or delay or not delay payments. So that is a risk that we should avoid at this stage. So that's point number two. Point number three, sir, is about this state, as it was mentioned earlier, about these tax holidays. That we are actually a very highly industrialized state. We have got industrial investment, as I told you, even FDI. But some of these investments have come on the basis of promises of tax holidays. Good for good or bad, we can debate whether that's a good idea or not. And hopefully in the future, we will not compete on tax holidays, as the finance minister himself said. We will compete on the status of infrastructure, on work culture, labor quality, training. But we have given tax holidays. So what do we do about that? These were tax holidays based on the state VAT. And some of them last for 10 or 12 years. So how are we going to now, after the imposition of GST, how are we going to take care of that? Are we going to front load the benefits and give them or something? So you'll have to think, and these are all unique to Maharashtra. Since the session today is about Maharashtra and GST, of course I will make some points about generally GST in general, but these are very unique to Maharashtra. But Maharashtra is a, what shall I say, terribly important state. I'm trying not to sound parochial here. Not only English may about this. But it's a very important state, and therefore please be, be aware. So thank you. That was the point I wanted to say. Fourth point is that after saying all this, let us also be aware that India is possibly the only country in the world and in modern history to implement this kind of a tax reform on such a large scale. We are a very, very diverse country. I mean, I need not say it here. There was one country which is quite homogeneous but which has two languages. It almost broke up in 1967 just because of the language dispute. I'm referring to Canada. So Quebec and Canada almost broke up because of language. It was, so you can imagine, we have multiple languages, multiple religions, ethnicities, race, culture, what have you. And here we are trying a unifying, I mean, of course, tax, we call it tax reform, but we are actually trying an experiment which no other large country has tried. In fact, the only other large country which is of federal nature, where we have provinces elected democratically, is the USA, and they don't have VAT. They don't have GST. So let us be aware of that and celebrate this success. As our finance minister said, that it was passed, as you said, in Rajya Sabha by 283-0. And in Lok Sabha again by 0. The number of votes voted against was 0. So this kind of an unprecedented consensus has never been seen in parliament, I think, ever. So we must celebrate that. This is a world where we have phenomena like Brexit. The countries are breaking up on issues like, you know, whether to join or leave European Union. It was fractious and such a deeply contested issue that one member of parliament was killed during the Brexit, in the days leading to Brexit. Then we have the phenomenon of the rise of Mr. Trump as a presidential candidate. So when the world is living with such divisive stuff on much simpler issues, we have got such unity and consensus on tax reform that we must celebrate. But we must be aware of the issues involved. So that, just a couple of other points I'd like to mention, and it has been said again and again, that while we are worrying about the loss of 7,000 crores of upcry or 14, the chief minister has said 14,000 crores, some numbers are 18,000 crores, but the positive part of it is that so far we were getting very little share of service taxes. In fact, as you know, the Finance Commission of India, when they allocate money to Maharashtra, it is only 4.8% of the divisible pool. Maharashtra has 15% of the share of industrial output, probably 11% of the share of national GDP, but we get 4.8% of the divisible pool of taxes. thanks to this, now this, we'll get half of the service tax collected, and Maharashtra has almost 58 or 60% of the state GDP is coming from services. So that is a positive point. And second point, as the finance minister himself said, don't forget that we are not only a manufacturing state or a producing state, we are also a large consuming state. This is the second most populous state, it is 110 million people. So it is GST is a destination-based principle. It's a, so consumption, consuming state will benefit. So let's not forget these two positive aspects. So therefore, the net may not be as bad. The other thing to note is that our buoyancy, you know, this I must point out that while our state industry's production has not been that good, even the national industrial production has not been going at more, I think, I don't know, 2 or 3%, 4%. You know, the industry is still trying to recover its higher growth rate. But the VAT collection, state VAT collection, which is purely based on industry, is growing at some 13 or 14% CAGR over the last 5 years. So, and mind you, this is only on industry. So I think that reflects buoyancy, that reflects the tight computerized control, that reflects the fact that leakages are low, that reflects the fact it's highly transparent. I remember that a few years ago, maybe 5 years ago, the state VAT collection doubled almost, 30 to 50% increase without any increase in VAT rates, simply because they got a 360 degree view of the computerization. In fact, that system is now going to be implemented at BMC also, but of course now we don't have Octroi, so I don't know, but that's going to be extended to the municipal corporation. So that also we must keep in mind. And then one last point before I go is that what actually our former chief minister also said, that let us, while GST is a reform, it has, you know, it's one tax, one country, one system, we call it, it will remove frictions, but it is an indirect tax. It is an indirect tax. Indirect taxes are paid by both by the rich and poor by the, to the same extent. So if it is 15% rate or 18% rate, 20% rate, that percent rate is applicable to rich or poor. Whether you buy a bar of soap, a toothpaste, a masala dosa, or a service haircut, it is 15-20%. Therefore, if you are poor, it's going to hurt your pocket much more than the rich. So inherently, the GST is a regressive tax. It's a tax reform, but it is a regressive tax. If it keeps increasing, it is going to hurt the poor more than the rich. It is a, that's just, it's that is by definition. Of course, people are going to get away by it by saying, let us have low rate for goods that the poor, agar wo bata, what is it? If it is a chappal, then we'll have 0% GST or 2% GST. If it is a fashionable shoe, what is it, Rockland boots, then it'll be 15%. That is actually not addressing the issue. That is, you know, that is like saying the poor people should not aspire to wear Rockland shoes. So inherently GST is a regressive tax. So unless we have, and by the way, I just want to tell you how regressive it is. India's industrial production in the last 5 months has grown by, in fact, the latest IIP number was negative. Index of industrial production for the month of August, I believe, is negative. Uske pehle it was 1 or 2%. But in those 5 months, excise duties, the same thing which GST is going to replace, have grown at 49%. India's excise duties in this fiscal year, in the last 5 months, have grown by 49%. Aisa kyun? Why did that happen? Because, unknown to you or very surreptitiously, petrol and diesel excise have been going 1 rupiah, 1.5 rupiah, 1 rupiah. You know, there's no agitation on the road on that. But that hurts everybody. That affects everybody. It affects our transportation. It affects the cost of transporting food from the villages to the cities. So it works very insidiously. That's why the CPI and WPI are going up now. So please be aware that GST is an indirect tax. So unless we have simultaneously direct tax reform, about which there is not much discussion, I don't know whether there is any enthusiasm for it. So I feel that we have to keep in mind GST is only half the work done. So unless we get the direct tax reform also, because India has the lowest tax.
इस समय सभी ने मिलकर एक सूर में एक विचार से जीएसटी के साथ में सब लोग खड़े हो गए. और ये अपने देश की विशेषता है कि जब 90 या 91 में जब सुधार की बात शुरू हो गई, ग्लोबलाइजेशन की बात शुरू हो गई, और उसके बाद कोई भी पार्टी की सत्ता है किसी ने उसमें रोकने की कोशिश नहीं की. बीच में कम्युनिस्ट लोग भी थे, देवी गौड़ा जी भी थे, किसी ने नहीं रोका, क्योंकि देश की विशेषता है. अभी जो बातें और प्रश्न मन में है, जैसे रानडे साहब को मुंबई का क्या होगा, हमारे पूर्व सीएम साहब है उन्होंने भी कुछ प्रश्न उपस्थित किए, उन्होंने कहा कि कोई नोटिफिकेशन निकल गया, अब उन्होंने बाद में जवाब दिया कि नोटिफिकेशन निकला और वो अधिकारी ने यह भी कहा कि इसमें क्या गलती हुई वो देखकर उसको सुधार लीजिए। आपने कहा अब गलती हो सकती है ना। अभी मुझे याद है कि हमारे विधानसभा की चर्चा में एक बार हमारे सीएम देवेंद्र फडणवीस जी ने, अब हमें 15 साल से आदत है, अब 5 वर्ष में पृथ्वीराज चौहान जी को मुख्यमंत्री मुख्यमंत्री कहने की आदत है, अभी देवेंद्र फडणवीस जी जो अभी के मुख्यमंत्री है उन्होंने गलती से पृथ्वीराज चौहान जी का नाम लेते समय मुख्यमंत्री लिया। अब गलती हुई इसका अधिकार नहीं मिलता, इसलिए कोई गलती केंद्र ने सेक्शन 17 में कर दी करके बहुत कुछ हो गया, ऐसा नहीं होता। अब उसमें उन्होंने कहा कि वो जो गलती है वो सुधारी जाएगी, इसलिए ऐसी गंभीरता नहीं है कि कुछ तो भी अलग होने वाला है, बहुत घटनात्मक पेश निर्माण हो गया है, अब ऑक्टाय 4 दिन से कैसा वसूल किया गया, एलबीटी कैसी वसूल की जाएगी, ये बातें प्रश्न उपस्थित नहीं होते। दूसरी बात जो हमारे सुभाष देसाई जी के मन में है और रानेडे जी के मन में, मुंबई का क्या होगा? अरे मुंबई का अच्छा ही होगा भाई, ऑक्टाय 7,000 कोटी आता है, आपको ये पता है 7,000 करोड़ में 3,500 करोड़ ये चंद्रपुर के लोग पैसा देते हैं, गढ़चिरौली के देता है, भामरागढ़ के देते हैं, क्योंकि महाराष्ट्र को ये चिंता है कि मुंबई अच्छी हो, हमारी राजधानी है, देश के आर्थिक राजधानी है, मुंबई मुंबई है, और इसमें 7,000 करोड़ में क्रूड ऑयल में जो 3,500 करोड़ ऑक्टाय आता है वो क्रूड ऑयल ये भामरागढ़ जाता है, ये क्रूड ऑयल इटापल्ली जाता है। फिर महाराष्ट्र के लोगों ने कभी ये कंप्लेंट नहीं की कि मुंबई को 3,500 करोड़ रुपए जो दिया जाता है वो हमारा है, क्योंकि मुंबई में सब लोग प्रेम करते हैं, तो महाराष्ट्र सरकार प्रेम नहीं करेगी क्या? दूसरी बात ऑटोनॉमी। अब पहली बात इकोनॉमी या ऑटोनॉमी, ऑटोनॉमी की जब बात करते हैं तो कल ये बात मन में क्यों डाले भाई कि राज्य में सरकार किसी और की है और महानगर पालिका में किसी और की सरकार होगी तो पैसा नहीं मिलेगा, फिर यही डर महानगर पालिका भी है कि महानगर पालिका में अगर किसी एक की सत्ता है और वार्ड में दूसरे पार्टी का नगर सेवक है तो उसके मन में डर हो जाएगा क्या? फिर वार्ड में एक नगर सेवक है, उसके वार्ड में कोई कांग्रेसी है, वो बीजेपी का नगर सेवक है, तो कांग्रेस के मतदाता के मन में डर हो जाएगा मेरा क्या होगा, ऐसा होता है क्या? डेमोक्रेसी में ऐसा नहीं होता है। अभी भी जब हमने ऑक्टाय 99 में निकाल दिया, क्या नगर परिषद की ऑटोनॉमी खत्म होगी? नहीं, उसके बाद नगर उत्थान योजना आई 19 हेड में, आखिर राज्य कोई प्रगति करते समय ऐसा तो नहीं प्रगति करेगा ना, उसको शहरों की प्रगति करनी पड़ेगी, और अपने देश की परंपरा है, विश्व के अपन हमेशा विश्व में हम आगे रहे, सही तो ये बात हमारे लिए सोचने की है कि 1650 तक विश्व के जीडीपी में 25% हिस्सा हमारा था, जिस देश के बारे में कहा जाता था कि ये सोन्याचा धूर आणि दुधाच्या नद्या वाहणारा देश है, पर यहाँ विकेंद्रीकरण नहीं हुआ, विषमता मुक्ति की बात नहीं हुई, जॉब क्रिएटर की जगह पे हमने जॉब सीकर की संख्या बढ़ाई, 1832 में जो मेटे ने भाषण दिया लंदन के पार्लियामेंट में हमने उस विषय में चर्चा की, और इसलिए हमारी व्यवस्थाओं में परिवर्तन के लिए बातें सोची जा रही है। जैसा मुझे याद है हम कोई भी बैठक में क्या पूछते हैं, बोले इसने खर्चा कम किया, गलत किया। मुझे हमेशा लगता है कि जो अधिकारी खर्चा कम करता है वो तो राज्य को इनडायरेक्ट मदद करता है, खर्चा कितना किया ये महत्वपूर्ण नहीं है, उसने खर्चा कैसा किया ये महत्वपूर्ण है। इसलिए कोई कारपोरेशन का ऑक्टाय जाने के बाद अब वो कारपोरेशन का क्या होगा, तो फिर विश्व में लंदन क्यों आगे जा रहा, वहां तो ऑक्टाय नहीं है, क्यों जा रहा भाई, हांगकांग आगे जा रहा है, क्यों ऑक्टाय नहीं है वहां पे, फिर भी आगे जा रहा है। कोई कोई अपने अपने मन से प्रश्न पूछता, किसी ने एक प्रश्न पूछा बोले मुंबई का ऑक्टाय समाप्त हो जाएगा तो आतंकवादी गतिविधियां बढ़ जाएगी, क्योंकि अभी ऑक्टाय के जो सेंटर्स है वहां से कोई आरडीएक्स लेके नहीं आ सकता। अगर ये मैंने अगर लॉजिक पकड़ा तो फिर नागपुर में तो ऑक्टाय नहीं है, ऑक्टाय का कोई नाता नहीं है, फिर आतंकवादी घटनाएं तो नागपुर में होनी चाहिए, मुंबई में क्यों हो रही थी? तो मुझे लगता है कि ये जो बातें है मन में शंकाएं है, ये शंकाओं का आधार सरकार को ढूंढना है, और सरकार निश्चित रूप से ढूंढने वाली है इस सभी बातों का आधार, क्योंकि सरकार ये जो सरकार आई है रानड़े साहब ये कोई 5 वर्ष के लिए नहीं आई है, हमें और 25 वर्ष काम करना है, तो हम ऐसी गलत बात नहीं होने देंगे कि जिसके माध्यम से हम 5 वर्ष के बाद छुट्टी हो जाएगी, नहीं होने देंगे। हमारा तो लक्ष्य ये है कि मंच पे से एक दिन पृथ्वीराज चौहान जी भी ये कहे कि मैं ये जो चाहता था वो सपना हमारी सरकार पूरी नहीं कर सकी। वो तो मोदी जी की सरकार ये पृथ्वीराज चौहान जी कहे और इसलिए जो शंका है मन में ये बात सही है शंकाएं रहना ये कोई गलत नहीं है और इसीलिए हमने भी ये तय किया है कि सरकार की व्याख्या को हम बदल रहे सरकार की व्याख्या में लोगों ने लोगों के लिए लोगों के मदद के बिना चलाई जाने वाली संस्था ये सरकार है हमने तय किया कि व्याख्या बदल दी है बदल देंगे लोगों ने लोगों के लिए लोगों की सूचनाओं के साथ मदद के साथ चलाने वाली संस्था यानी सरकार है और इसी आधार पर तो मैंने कहा कि हम लोगों के बीच में जा रहे हैं लोगों के बीच में जाके जो समस्या है उसका निराकरण कैसे करेंगे ताला है तो चाबी है प्रश्न है तो उसके जवाब भी है वो जवाब हम समाज से समझना चाहते हैं और समाज के सामने जा रहे हैं जीएसटी काउंसिल क्यों बनेगी मुझे किसी ने कहा कि वो एक बार कानून परफेक्ट बन जाए अरे देश की घटना में भी तो 122 की घटना दुरुस्ती करनी पड़ी इतने सब बड़े बड़े लोग रहने के बाद भी वक्त के साथ बदलना पड़ता है उसके साथ हमने 122 की घटना दुरुस्ती की है तो किसी ने यह कहना कि परिपूर्ण कानून एक दिन में बन जाएगा क्या तो परिपूर्ण कानून एक दिन में नहीं बनेगा हमें उसको बदलना पड़ेगा ऑटोनॉमी या मेंटेलिटी अब ऑटोनॉमी तो दी थी ना ऑटोनॉमी देने के बाद फिर अभी भी प्रश्न क्यों है समाज में नहीं दी थी क्या ऑटोनॉमी कॉर्पोरेशन को नहीं थी अभी हम चिंता कर रहे हैं ऑटोनॉमी की क्या पहले ऑटोनॉमी नहीं थी क्या ऑक्टाय नहीं था क्या एलबीटी नहीं था क्या फिर शहरों में आज भी समस्याएं क्यों खड़ी है आज भी शहरों में पीने का पानी हम क्यों नहीं दे रहे आज भी महानगर पालिका क्षेत्र में 50% से ज्यादा लोग हलनदारी मुक्त महानगर पालिका नहीं बना सके अभी भी हमारे 26 में से 2 या 3 कोल्हापुर जैसी महानगर पालिका हलनदारी मुक्त बनी स्वच्छता में हम आगे नहीं जा सके जबकि ऑक्टाय था ना नहीं था क्या ऑक्टाय ऑटोनॉमी नहीं थी क्या अभी हमें ऑटोनॉमी की बात करते समय मेंटेलिटी की बात करनी पड़ेगी हमें आगे जाना है और वही तो नरेंद्र भाई मोदी जी चाहते हैं कि हमारे देश में कोई ये बात नहीं है कि शहर कैसा भी हो जाएगा शहर का विकास नहीं होगा शहर में समस्या रहेगी इसलिए तो हमने स्मार्ट सिटी की कल्पना लगाई ना कि देश में सब शहर को हम स्मार्ट बनाएंगे सरकार पैसे देगी कुछ कॉर्पोरेशन देगी कुछ राज्य सरकार देगी उसमें भी बदलाव होगा इसलिए मुझे लगता है कि ये बातें जो है हमें सोचने की है हमारे सामने जो प्रश्न आए हैं अभी भी कुछ प्रश्न है बहुत सारे प्रश्न मैंने लिखे मगर मुझे वक्त का रखा जाए ये प्रश्नों का जवाब सरकार के माध्यम से निश्चित रूप से जाएगा अब ये बात पूछी जाती बोले केंद्र सरकार एलबीटी का पैसा देगी क्या अब मुझे एक बात समझ में नहीं आ रही कि एलबीटी और ऑक्टाय हटाने के लिए महाराष्ट्र में अभी तक 21 कमेटियां बनी सब बड़े बड़े अधिकारी सब जिनको हम कह सकते कि बुद्धिमंत लोग हैं ये बुद्धिमान लोगों ने कहा ना ऑक्टाय हटाओ करके ये तो अर्थ मंत्री के नाते हमने नहीं कहा ये तो उन 21 समितियों के माध्यम से आया है ऑक्टाय हटाना चाहिए हाँ बात ये थी कि पृथ्वीराज चौहान जी के सरकार ने भी जो समितियां बनाई थी उसके पहले वो समितियों ने ऑक्टाय हटाने की बात की अब चौहान साहब ने हिम्मत नहीं बताई वो हम बता रहे इतना ही फर्क बाकी इसमें कोई अड़चन नहीं समितियां तो हमने थोड़ी बनाई मैं आने के बाद कोई समिति नहीं बनी 21 समितियां बनी सबने कहा कि ऑक्टाय ये विश्व का एक ऐसा कर प्रणाली का रूप है जो लोगों को सहजता से टैक्स देने की बात नहीं करता लोगों को तकलीफ की बात करता है और इसलिए मुंबई की भी हमने विधानसभा में बार बार कहा कि हम कानून में दे रहे अच्छा फिर प्रश्न आता हुआ अभी जो टैक्स बढ़ रहा है हर साल बढ़ेगा उसका क्या होगा उसका भी सूत्र बनेगा एलबीटी जब हमने माफ की उसका भी सूत्र बना तो मुझे लगता है कि हमने मन में प्रश्न लेकर यहां से नहीं जाना हमने एक निर्णय जीएसटी के माध्यम से देश के सब राजनीतिक पार्टियों ने यह तय किया कि हम सबको जीएसटी के माध्यम से आगे जाना है जो भी समस्या है जो भी शंका है उसमें प्रश्न है कानून के प्रावधान है कोई सेक्शन में बदलाव है तो ये तो हम सब मिलकर वो बदलाव करेंगे सब लोग हमको देश को आगे ले जाना है तो देश आगे ले जाने के लिए हमारे पास तो सबसे अच्छा मुद्दा है तो हम जा सकते हैं और मुझे विश्वास है कि भारत की जनता पे विश्वास है भारत के लोगों पे विश्वास है जैसे मन में ये प्रश्न क्यों आया कि वो आप जब करोगे इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स है तो गरीब को भी उतना लगेगा अमीर को भी उतना लगेगा हाँ जिस दिन गरीब भी कार खरीदेगा अमीर भी कार खरीदेगा उस दिन दोनों को टैक्स लगेगा तो इनडायरेक्ट मगर जीवनावश्यक वस्तु जो कंज्यूमर प्राइस इंडेक्स के बास्केट में है 52% वैसे भी माफ है ना तो उसमें आज भी महाराष्ट्र में हल्दी पे टैक्स नहीं चीज पे नहीं चावल पे नहीं गेहूं पे नहीं ज्वारी पे नहीं तो वही जीएसटी आने के बाद जो जीवनावश्यक चीजें है जो साधारण रूप से गरीब व्यक्ति खरीदता है उस बारे में बात होनी है इसलिए इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स जीवनावश्यक वस्तुओं पे लगने की संभावना बहुत कम है कि जिसके वजह से ये हम बोल रहे कि अमीर आदमी पे भी इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स लगेगा, गरीब पे भी लगेगा। हाँ ये बात सही है कि अगर अमीर आदमी भी कार खरीदेगा और गरीब आदमी भी कार खरीदेगा तो इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स दोनों पे समान लगेगा, मगर कुछ टैक्स एक्सेम्प्शन मिलने वाले। फिर आए उद्योग की बात, मगर उद्योग का हमने वैट की माफी दी थी, इसके बारे में क्या होगा? इसमें धीरे धीरे काम किया जाएगा, धीरे धीरे समितियां बन रही है, इसमें हम इसको कैसे धारदार बना सकते हैं। कानून को ऐसा बनाना है और जीएसटी को ऐसा बनाना है कि 25 वर्ष तक हमारी सरकार नहीं जानी चाहिए, और ऐसा ही कानून बनेगा यह हमारा विश्वास है। और मैं आपको सबको क्षमा चाहता हूं, मैं अब यहां से जाता हूं क्योंकि मुझे और काम है, मगर एक बात मैं बता कर जाता हूं कि आपकी ये चर्चा सुनने के बाद मेरे मन में एक निर्णय मैंने कर लिया, मैं अभी यहां से निकला कि पहला काम कहता करता हूं कि हमारे कमिश्नर को हमारी वेबसाइट एकदम अपग्रेड करने को कहता हूं। आपके मन में कोई भी समस्या, कोई भी प्रश्न, कोई भी सजेशन, कोई भी सूचना हो, देश के लिए आप चाहते हैं कि आपके ज्ञान से कोई ऐसी व्यवस्था में परिवर्तन की कोई बात है, वो बात आप हमारे वेबसाइट पे कह दो। आपका मार्गदर्शन जीएसटी को और अच्छा बनाएगा, राज्य को तरक्की के मार्ग पर ले जाएगा, ये मेरा विश्वास है। अभी जाने के बाद मेरे वेबसाइट को मैं इतना अपडेट कर देता हूँ, लेकिन यहाँ प्रश्न में अगर अपने ही मन के प्रश्न और जवाब देते रहूंगा तो बहुत प्रश्न आ जाएंगे, आ जाएगा, मगर खुद मैं पढ़ूंगा और जो जो अच्छे सजेशन है जो हमको भी ध्यान में नहीं आते, ऐसा कोई जरूरी नहीं है कि हमें हर बात ध्यान में आएगी, वो सारे अच्छी सूचना है वो तर्क शास्त्र के आधार पर उसको दुरुस्त करेंगे और हम सब मिलकर हमारा महाराष्ट्र एक था एक आगे रहेगा, इसलिए हम सब मिलकर काम करेंगे। कोई राजनीतिक यहाँ विचार नहीं, राजनीतिक पार्टी नहीं, मुझे याद है और मुझे लगता है कि अभी बहुत अच्छे भले व्यक्ति है जिनको मैं बहुत चाहता हूँ और आपको आपको विश्वास नहीं होगा तो मेरा एक राइटिंग में पत्र है उनके पास 2 साल पहले और मैंने वो पत्र भी लिखा था 2 वर्ष पहले, उनको पूछ लेना मैं झूठ नहीं कह रहा हूँ, उनको 2 वर्ष पहले सीएम रहते हुए मैंने लिखा था कि अटल जी के बारे में कांग्रेस के संसद ने ऐसा कहा था कि अटल जी बहुत अच्छे व्यक्ति है, भले व्यक्ति है, राइट पर्सन इन रॉन्ग पार्टी, ऐसे कांग्रेस के संसद ने कहा मगर वो बात गलत थी, वो राइट पर्सन इन राइट पार्टी थी, मगर वो बात आपके बारे में सही है। पूछ लेना मेरे जाने के बाद, मैंने लिखा था वो बहुत अच्छे व्यक्ति है और हम चाहते हैं उनका अनुभव हमसे 1000 गुना ज्यादा है, उनका भी मार्गदर्शन हमें मिले। और मुझे आज के इस कार्यक्रम की रूपरेखा मुझे पता नहीं कि मुझे ऐसा लगा कि कोई जीएसटी पे कोई संवाद है, मुझे जाके इनॉग्रेशन करना है, घर पे नहीं जाना, मुझे ये नहीं पता था। मैं तो फिर बाकी सभी बातें लेके आता था, मैं कितने परसेंटेज में क्या है, 10 साल में क्या हुआ है, 20 साल में क्या होने वाला है, आगे 15 साल में क्या होने वाला है, देश कैसा बदलने वाला है, अच्छे दिन कैसे आने वाले हैं, वक्त का कटा गया है और इसलिए मैं ज्यादा समय तो रह नहीं पाऊंगा, और जाते समय इस राज्य का वित्त मंत्री के नाते जब तक मुख्यमंत्री जी मुझे वित्त मंत्री के पद पर रखेंगे तब तक ये विश्वास मैं आपको देता हूँ कि महाराष्ट्र का सिर्फ भला ही होने के लिए पूरी ताकत के साथ काम करेंगे, अर्थव्यवस्था मजबूत करने के लिए काम करेंगे। आज 5.8% से हमने विकास दर 8% तक किया, इसको और आगे बढ़ाने के लिए ताकत लगाएंगे और हमारे राज्य को प्रगति के मार्ग पे जाते समय यह हमारा विश्वास है कि मराठा वैसे भी मराठी आदमी ये अटके पार झंडा लाना है, और जब कभी हमें मदद की जरूरत पड़ती तो आम्ही सुरतेवर स्वारी करणाऱ्याचे वंश लावो, त्याच्यामुळे देशाच्या तिजोरीतून पैसे कसे आणायचे आणि राज्याला प्रगतीच्या मार्गावर याची चिंता करू नका। धन्यवाद।
Thank you, sir, for being here. Now it's Niren Sethia, who is an associate director at PwC India, that is PricewaterhouseCoopers India. His work involves providing assistance in relation to advisory, litigation, compliance services for indirect taxes. His work also involves market and team development and acquiring new clients.
Good evening. Respected dignitaries, dear friends, and future of Maharashtra and the country. Though a lot has been spoken on GST till now, and after the animated session and very aggressive session by our dear Honorable Minister, I am now going to make the session a little technical. So, we all understand that GST is coming and the government is working for many, many years. Do we understand why is the requirement for GST? Do we all understand that what would GST bring a change about? Will it help the common man? Will it help the country? Will it help each and every person sitting in the room? So what are your broad thoughts? Just loudly, if you can just speak from wherever you're sitting. That why do you think will GST literally help the countrymen or no? Yes, anybody? Pardon me? Okay. Anything else? What will happen because of cascading effect going down?
Overlapping of taxes will be reduced.
Very good. As a result of which, what will happen? Exactly. Who mentioned this? Wonderful. She's my colleague. That's why she answered. Okay. No, jokes apart. Okay. So the point is this, that what will happen? Just imagine today somebody who imports a product in the country and he's a dealer in the state of Maharashtra. He pays an element which is BCD, which is basic customs duty. Then he pays CVD. He pays SAD. He has an element object. He has an opportunity to get the refund of SAD. But the CVD element in it of 12.5% is a cost in his transaction. As a result of which, when he resells that product in the state of Maharashtra or he does an interstate sale, what happens is he builds his profit margin on that excise duty or the CVD element. Actually, it is not called CVD, it is called additional duty of customs. That additional duty of customs element, that is a cost, and as a result of which the product for you, for us, for everybody is expensive. What will happen in GST? In GST, one of the various benefits, tax cascading or reduction in price is one of them. But there are many more benefits. One benefit which is there is, on the same product, when he will import now, what he will pay will be BCD, and next what element will he pay will be IGST. And IGST will be available as set-off. As it will be available as set-off, it is not a cost in the transaction. As it is not a cost in the transaction, it becomes cheaper for us. Because now, he will take a credit of it, load his margin on the basic cost plus BCD, as a result of which the product will become cheaper, and the product will become beneficial for us. Hence, GST, yes, it will have its teething issues. It will have a lot of time for it to settle down in the country, amongst the people, and it's going to be online, there's going to be a lot of uploading of data, a lot of stuff is going to happen when people will go in GST. But yes, few years down the line, the real benefit of GST will be seen. So going into, so that was first part of my discussion, which was why GST. I'll now go into specifics to Maharashtra and how, we foresee the income of Maharashtra or the revenues of Maharashtra. Yeah. So presently there was a survey done some time back, and as per that research by India Spend, the most industrialized country, state in the country, and the most populous state in the country, which is Maharashtra and Uttar Pradesh respectively, both are expected to get the same amount of revenue which it will lose if it was in GST. As per the report, around 60,000 crores of revenue will be subsumed in GST, and that's about the same amount of revenue which Maharashtra will earn when it will be in GST. So the expectation is, and this survey covers the 60,000 crores to include LBT, to cover entry tax, to cover octroi, to cover VAT, all those taxes, entertainment tax, all those taxes which will get subsumed in GST, and those which will not be subsumed in GST. So it's a detailed report which was done a couple of years back, and as per which the survey says that yes, Maharashtra and Uttar Pradesh, both, because one is the most populous and one is the most industrialized, both will earn the same amount of revenue. Keeping this in mind, and as even somebody mentioned over here, that Maharashtra is the second most populous state, which means we are most industrialized and second most populous. So it is possible that our revenue could be more than what is expected. Though these are all, a lot is going to depend upon the revenue which Maharashtra will earn out of services. Let me now, you know, just touch upon certain points with respect to, you know, where is it that there will be a loss of revenue and where is it there will be an increase in revenue. We all understand that entry tax, octroi, LBT, VAT, all these entertainment tax all will go away. What we will get in return would be the eligibility to tax goods and services, the eligibility of consumption. Now, this is where it is going to be very crucial for us to understand that what is the source of revenue. So GST, if you all understand, and as indirect taxes are, it works on the concept of destination-based consumption tax. So what is the meaning of destination-based consumption tax? Anybody over here, please? What do we mean by the concept of destination-based consumption tax? Does it mean the state where, you know, activities are happening? Does it mean the state where, or the place where the consumption is happening? Does it mean the place where manufacturing is happening? What is the thought? Yeah, that's right. So the word says destination-based consumption tax. So it is consumption. What does it mean? It means that state will be the owner of the revenue only where there's a consumption happening. So let's now look at the present scenario. Today when there's a sale of goods which happens, and what is the source of revenue for Maharashtra is the sale of goods. What is the revenue there? The scope of the taxing entry, it covers all sales which originate from Maharashtra. So goods which are sold from Maharashtra to Gujarat, what a tax which is levied is central sales tax, but the revenue of that goes to state of Maharashtra. That in GST will change. In GST, the destination of that sale, if it is Gujarat, the revenue will go to the state of Gujarat. Hence, to that extent, that tax will not belong to the state of Maharashtra. That is in the case of goods. But which is very simple, because goods, you know, you can find out tangibility, you can find out movement. So assuming some soap is manufactured in Maharashtra, transferred to a warehouse in Karnataka, from there transferred and sold in a state of Tamil Nadu, the tax moves along with it, and hence the consumption happens in the respective state. So ultimately, the tax will go and sit in the state in which the consumption happens. What happens in the case of services? And that is a big question mark which is there for everybody. Everybody believes that, you know, Maharashtra being the financial capital of the country, one, and being a huge consumer of services, a lot of the service revenue will come to the state of Maharashtra. It is important here to understand that not all activities would be covered within the realm of Maharashtra jurisdiction, and as a result of which, not all activities or the revenue from there would be Maharashtra's revenue. Let's go sector by sector here to understand what the impact would be. Let's take the first and foremost, the largest financial services sector. Question is, if the banks are in Maharashtra, or let's say for the sake of discussion, the largest two exchanges, NSE and BSE, they are in Maharashtra, would all the revenue of broking, would all the revenue of banking, would all the revenue of the NBFC sector, again the largest sector in Maharashtra, would it be in the state of Maharashtra? So the concept is clearly identified by the concept of place of supply rules. As per place of supply rules, the consumption of that activity will be in that place where the customer is located. Then let's take for the example, I am an account holder of HDFC Bank, for example, and if I have given on record, and assuming I am from the state of Rajasthan and I have moved and working in the state of Maharashtra, but on record my address in the bank or records of HDFC Bank is Rajasthan, whatever revenue or whatever services HDFC Bank provides to me, the revenue on that will go to the state of Rajasthan and not Maharashtra. Similarly, take broking services. When broking services and a broker does an activity of buying and selling of securities for a customer, if the customer again is, he is sitting here, it's all online, he does on a bolt or he does on a online mechanism, irrespective of where the customer is sitting, again, if the customer in another state, then the consumption of that service is in that state, and hence the revenue will go to that state. So the broker in Maharashtra will raise an invoice which will be an IGST invoice. I am presuming people understand what is IGST. that there will be an IGST invoice which you will raise, and Maharashtra government will have to transfer that revenue, or non-Maharashtra, it will basically the central government will transfer that revenue to the destination state and not to the state of Maharashtra, because the consumption of services in the state of where the customer is located. Insurance. Maximum insurance companies are in the state of Maharashtra. Life insurance or general insurance. Now, what is going to happen in this in insurance? It is a contract of insurance between the insurance company and the policyholder, which means that the consumption again is at the place where the policyholder is residing in the case of an individual who is not registered, obviously. Which means that the entire customer base of all insurance companies is going to be across the country, which would mean that when the insurance company is paying a GST, the tax would be paid in the state in which the customer or the policyholder is located and not in the state of Maharashtra. It will, the company will only make a payment in the state of Maharashtra and not to the state of Maharashtra, will make a payment to IGST or the central government. The central government will transfer the entire revenue depending on the policyholders across the country in the respective states. That's the way the insurance sector will work. Similarly goes with mutual funds, similarly goes with broking, similarly goes with banking, similarly goes with NBFCs. Let's look at some other sector, aviation sector. Aviation sector goes by the concept of embarkation. Embarkation means from where you start your journey. Hence, for example, if there's a person who is traveling to Dubai from Cochin and the flight is Cochin, Dubai, Maharashtra, Dubai, the journey he embarked in Dubai and Cochin, which is from where the revenue, the journey is commenced, so the revenue will be in the state of Kerala and not in the state of Maharashtra, though the flight is embarking from Dubai, Maharashtra to Dubai also, where his journey started. Similarly, if it's a reverse journey, Bombay, Cochin, Dubai, the revenue is to Maharashtra because the entire journey started from Maharashtra. So the concept is embarkation. Hence, if an agent books a ticket of a person outside the state and he from there takes a ticket, which is, he may be in Maharashtra, he may not be in Maharashtra, but where the journey originates or embarks, at that place is the consumption of the service and at that place is the revenue. Now these are, I guess you are understanding that it is not a simple factor that merely because the customer isn't, like for example, take us, PwC is providing services to customers across the country. The question is my consumption of service where I am? All our services are online today. We hardly and rarely go to client places. A lot of it happens over emails. A lot of it happens over calls and video calls. Where is the consumption? The consumption is where the customer's registered address is. For example, if the customer is, for the sake of discussion, an ACC company. ACC company would have registered addresses across the country wherever their place of business is. Hence, if I am providing a service which is connected to one particular branch of theirs, irrespective of whether ACC's head office is in Maharashtra, the revenue will go to that state where the consumption of services. Hence, it will be important for us to identify the place of consumption where the service consuming is getting consumed. I have spoken on some sectors. One very important sector is going to be e-commerce, extensively being used nowadays. The question is, on e-com platform, what gets sold is either good consumption of goods or consumption of services. Goods, again, will depend on how they are coming inside the state for consumption, and services, where which services are consumed depending on where the customer is. Today, most e-com players stock their goods in the state of, in areas like Bhiwandi or in Maharashtra, from where interstate sales happen. Tomorrow, all those sales will be basically supplies, and the revenue of all those supplies will go to the destination state in which the consumption of those supplies are happening. So e-com would be only a platform, but the underlying transaction of goods or services is going to be key to identify whether that revenue will be to the state of Maharashtra or will it be to some other state. Hence, all these various, you know, sectors which I spoke on, entertainment, media, again, it is going to be, like for example, in the place of supply rules, this is very surprising and this is very unique. There is a provision which particularly says that if a company advertises something on behalf of the state government or the central government, then the advertiser or the company would have to pay that respective service GST in the on a reverse charge basis in each of the states where the service was consumed. For example, if it's a beneficial scheme relating to the seven sisters on the east of India, then they have to pay respective GST on each of the seven states. But for example, if it is an all India campaign, then they have to pay across the country, which is the case when it's a government and a private sector, government and an advertiser. However, when if the transaction is between a private party and the advertiser, like say for example, for the sake of discussion, HUL giving a contract to Lintas that, okay, you all go ahead and advertise a campaign for me. In that case, there is a big doubt right now, where will the consumption be? Because the advertising service does not get consumed at one place. It gets consumed across the country. As it gets consumed across the country, and if for the sake of discussion, HUL has its head office in Maharashtra, the revenue, whether should it belong to the entire state of Maharashtra or should be divided across the country, is something which is not clear. And these ambiguities which I'm speaking of where the place of consumption is something which is opened right now. Because there are many aspects of this for services difficult to identify where the place of consumption is. It could be, for example, a simple example. Mutual fund companies or insurance companies, they appoint brokers or distributors or agents to market their products in a zonal area. Like for example, somebody may appoint a broker in Karnataka, say you circulate or you advertise my products in those areas. He has a contract with the insurance company in Maharashtra. Is he providing a service interstate or is he providing a localized service? And if he is providing a localized service and if he raises an IGST invoice, basically the revenue comes to Maharashtra. So this is bringing into question, where is the place of consumption? And I can go into many other sectors. I have like telecommunication and I have stockbroking, freight forwarding, another very classical case. Freight forwarding, again, the concept is that you have to go by where the customer is registered. So again, let's take an example. Here, there is a customer, say for example, L&T places a contract with a freight forwarder, kindly transfer my goods from my factory in Gujarat to my customer in Chennai. Where is the place of consumption? And is it again L&T only in Maharashtra? Is it Chennai where the ultimately it was destined to? Or is it Gujarat from where the journey commenced? Not clear. These aspects are being debated right now and various representations are being made on this aspect on the place of supply. So to summarize, I think for the state of Maharashtra to understand what is the impact of GST. Look, today what happens is that in the centralized service tax regime, where everybody has taken a centralized registration and for the country as a whole, they do their compliance at one location. For the sake of discussion again, I've used a lot of names here in my entire discussion. These are all hypothetical examples. Please don't quote it anywhere. HDFC, no, I don't know. This is getting recorded and I don't know where it gets goes after. For example, HDFC is centrally registered in Maharashtra. It does its all India compliance in Maharashtra. And if it is paying service tax in Maharashtra today, does it mean that in GST, can Maharashtra assume that my entire revenue, which is today HDFC is paying, going to become my revenue? Answer is no. It is not the case. And this is just one example. If you keep replicating this sector by sector, entity by entity, you will realize that yes, the actual revenue which will come to the state of Maharashtra is going to be that revenue which is depending upon the actual consumption of goods and services. And hence, what will have to be seen is that how much is the goods and services, which probably right now I am definitely not equipped to know how much is the consumption, and which we will come to know when the law is finalized, when it is in operation, and at that point in time, a proper estimate or guesstimate will be made that how much is the consumption. To summarize, but I will say one thing, that the concept of one tax, one country, one market is actually a superb concept. And will definitely go down the path of ease of doing business. Because ultimately, there may be teething issues for everybody, which is individuals, which are consumers, which are customers, which are dealers, which may be companies. There's a lot of technology change which has to undergo. The technology change is humongous to understand. There is one technology change which the government has to do, but more complex than that is a technology change which the companies have to do or individuals have to do or SACs have to do, because now they have to identify the place of consumption of their supply. Today I am supplying to somebody in Rajasthan. I have to report that much to the state of Rajasthan. I supply so much to Delhi. I have to report that much to Delhi. Not relevant in the present world. because it was not relevant because I was paying only CST in Maharashtra or I was under a centralized service tax registration doing only compliance in Maharashtra. So it did not matter where the customer was, did not matter where the consumption was. This both will make a big change in GST. Coupled with it, the issue of credits will come in because all credits will be again localized. If there are branches which are branches in local areas, say for example, again I go back to my classical example of HDFC, it is a branch in Kerala. That Kerala registration is a separate registration. The credit in that registration is separate registration, separate credit. You cannot utilize that for discharging your liability in Maharashtra, which means now companies or systems or technologies will have to recognize respective localized credits, respective localized liabilities, and doing this entire change has to be incorporated in the system. Hence, the point is, yes, it is going to be a warpathing situation. A lot of companies, and as we speak, a lot of them have already initiated the process of GST transition. Still, I think it's a tip of the iceberg situation. There are lakhs and lakhs of assessees which have still not started the process. It is not going to be an easy process. It is going to be taking its time. There are going to be a lot of teething issues. To me, more than the teething issues is the mindset issue of averse to change, that we are not ready to the change. It is such a big issue. It's a system issue. Once it is overcome, then the future of GST and the future of the country and the future of tax reform is very sound and strong. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Niren, sir. I would now like to invite Professor Abhay Pethe to give his concluding remarks on the session.
As always, I'm going to be brief because I'm not going to attempt to summarize or whatever of all that was said. A few points. Number one, that it's great that we have somehow managed to come to this point as far as GST is concerned. And this has been across party lines and across regimes that this effort has happened. And for a change, we see a little of statesmanship, unlike ever before. And that's a good thing. There are lots and lots of problems, and everyone actually pointed out to the thing. The last speaker, of course, pointed out to a lot of issues that would arise vis-a-vis especially services. And there's a lot of capacity building that will need to be done. Some of the problems, one of the things that has to be taken on board has to be, to my mind, the arbitration mechanism that was talked of. That's very essential. That has to be away from the GST Council. And also the point made by Mr. Prithviraj Chavan about the new cadre that needs to come about. I think somehow we need to think about these things and the consensus building. We have started on this road of political consensus building, even going forward and sorting out all the difficulties. Let's not take shortcuts of, majoritism kind of a thing, but have political consensus building is the kind of thing. After all, remember what we have in place is a flawed GST. We have not got the GST 1 that is supposed to be the ideal GST, one rate, no slabs, central government, one window and all that. That would be the ideal thing. We are anyway away from the ideal GST. We already have flawed GST. We already are going to make our friends from the corporate sector go to more than one windows and fill more than one forms. And there are going to be slabs, etc., which slowly will be subsumed and under fewer and fewer, and finally we hope for one kind of. So there is a lot of traveling to do yet, but we are here, and there are just two other points that I want to make. Finally, one is Ajit says talked about indirect taxes by definition being bad, and Bad meaning regressive. Yeah, yeah. That's bad, isn't it? I mean, that's the implicit value that we have. It's a consumption tax, Ajit. So expenditure taxes, don't we always believe, are the best taxes anyway? I mean, you need indirect taxes. So this is the best of the worst kind of situation that we have to do it. But the other point is equally well made, that this is half the story and we need to work on the DTC part of it. And so that we can have the tax reform and reach that tax GDP ratio to somewhere around 2025. Octroi was talked about and where the money is going to come and so on and so forth. I think somewhere in the constitutional amendment itself, there ought to have been this provision. We have missed that bus. Now, I don't know how the state legislation is going to do that. Yeah. And the other issue is about what will happen after 5 years. See, after all, if you do believe that GST is a great tax and it's such a big reform that it's going to give a push and a tax dividend and all that, then without GST kind of business as usual path of tax revenues that you would be getting would be far surpassed by what you would be getting here. The question is, cities will not be getting that because octroi is not there. And this is where I want to make the point that cities by themselves nowhere in the world are self-sufficient. Property tax, even with the best of coverages, only covers 30% of cities' expenditures. So what we will need to do is what we already have in place, which is have the state finance commissions devolve to cities and the local bodies. Because the state finance commissions, even in a progressive state like Maharashtra, have never been taken seriously when it came to financial awards, we don't know, I mean, we don't experience this. Nowhere in the world this has, nowhere in India actually it has happened, except in Kerala where it's not actually the SFC, but the planning thing, devolution happens in a systemic way. So, whether after 5 years or just now, if the tax dividend comes greatly to the state, what it will have to do is to enter a contract, a caveat with the cities, which will give comfort to the cities. This is difficult because the cities don't actually believe that the states will do it. Their historical experience does not give them reason for this comfort. But somehow if there is a shadow of the central government in that contract, or if we use the finance commission route, so that even before going to the consolidated fund of the state, somehow if we can get it out, now whether this is constitutional, whether it requires a legislative nod, or whether this is can be done by executive order is a different matter. But we'll need to find out something like this, a way of devolution. Because octroi is bad, it has to go. There is no two ways about it. There aren't enough revenue handles with the cities. Because all the revenue handles that were supposed to be, which we teach in the classroom, whether it's the professions tax or the local sales tax or the entertainment tax or the motor vehicle tax, already are being usurped by the state government. And one rule that we know is that once it's been taken, it's not going to be given back. So that, forget about that route. So we'll need to work like this. And this constitutional amendment specifically for Maharashtra could have happened because of the peculiarity of Maharashtra. After all, we have 371(2) done for Maharashtra. So we could have gone for constitution. We missed that bus. Now we'll have to follow this bus. You know, we organized this program, Neeraj organized this program. I don't know how much briefing he did to the people who were called here, probably not. We will improve on that, I'm sure, because as the finance minister said, he didn't have really a clue about what to expect, and he kept on asking me whether there were going to be people from the audience coming, etc. But India runs on faith, you know. And we have our marriages, which we organize in various ways. In the end, it all comes together and we manage it pretty well. So thank you for having this patience and spending 3 hours of your time at a stretch. Wow. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Thank you so much for your valuable comments, sir. I, on the behalf of the Department of Economics, would like to extend our sincere thank yous to all our esteemed panelists for being here tonight. You have graced us with your presence and your invaluable ideas and opinions, and we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for being here. This session has been very enlightening. I'm sure if all of you all will agree with the same. A big thank you to the Department of Economics as well, Mumbai University, for being the driving force behind this vision. An event like this cannot take place overnight, and we have been fortunate to have been backed by very dedicated and motivating volunteers who worked alongside the department and culminated this vision into the success story that it is. Lastly, a big thank you to the audience. You guys have been very diligent, very dynamic, and I hope you guys turn out for the next event that we have as well with the same enthusiasm. Thank you all for being here today, this afternoon. This has been a pleasure. Thank you.
Well, just an announcement. All of you are welcome to join us for a high tea, which is being served immediately outside the auditorium. Thank you.